Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Charleston's Daughter by Sabra Waldfogel, narrated by Allyson Johnson. Part 1. Widows and Orphans, 1858. Chapter 1. A Father's Love. Caro lingered in the doorway of her mother's room to watch as Belle brushed her mother's gleaming dark hair. "Don't pull so, Belle," her mother said. Belle was 16. She was brown as a pecan and spoke with the thick accent of her home in the Low Country. She had just arrived at the Jarvie house on St. Helena Island, an hour's ferry ride south of Charleston. Caro's father, soft-hearted about all his servants, had asked her mother to take her on as a lady's maid, even though Belle had been a kitchen maid all her life.
"I'm sorry, ma'am," Belle murmured.
"It's all right. Give me the brush." Belle extended the brush as though it were a stirring spoon. Her mother pulled it from Belle's hand with a sigh of exasperation.
"I'll do it."
When Caro was very small, she loved to watch her mother at her dressing table as she brushed her hair. Caro had loved the hairbrush, too, a shining tortoiseshell with a gleaming silver inlay. Her father had given her a similar brush on her last birthday, and as a further extravagance, he'd had it engraved with her initials, CJ, for Caroline Jarvie. Belle hunched a little as she waited. She muttered,
"Ma'am, do you still need me?"
"No. Go downstairs and see if you can help Dulcie." Dulcie was the cook. Belle ducked her head.
"Yes, ma'am."
Her footsteps echoed heavily on the back stairs. Kitty sighed.
"She acts like she's fresh from the rice field," she said.
It was unfair. She brushed her own hair and asked Caro,
"Do I look all right?"
Caro put her hands on her mother's shoulders and regarded the dual reflection in the dressing table mirror.
"You look lovely, Mama," she said.
Twice Caro's age, her mother was as beautiful as ever and as proud of praise. Kitty turned to kiss her on the cheek.
"You too," she said.
"We look just alike,"
Caro said, teasing her. She ignored it.
"Is the dress all right?"
Their similar looks were enhanced by their similar dresses, pretty and made from lightweight cotton, suitable for a warm summer evening at home. Her father liked to see his ladies well-dressed, even if they didn't go out.
"As pretty as mine."
Kitty shook her head.
"Hand me my earbobs, the diamonds."
The diamond earrings had been a gift from her father when Caro was born. When her mother tossed her head, the diamonds flashed and the gold gleamed. They dazzled, like the slender, dark-eyed woman whose figure showed no evidence of having born a daughter 18 years ago, or of having conceived and lost two children since. Kitty regarded herself in the mirror again and nodded in satisfaction. She held out her arm.
"Shall we? Your father is waiting."
She walked with a sprightly step as they descended the mahogany staircase, which was gleaming from its weekly polish. She glanced at the portraits on the staircase wall.
"Dusty," she said. "Someone isn't doing her duty."
Caro peeked at the portraits, which were glossy enough to show the dust. They were pictures of her father as a young man and the wife he had married when he was young. Caro didn't mind seeing a coat of dust on Eliza Harriet's flawless face. Eliza had been an heiress as well as a beauty, bringing her own holdings in Colleton County to add to her new husband's, giving him 1,000 acres and 500 slaves, making him a wealthy planter as well as a successful Charleston lawyer. She had disappointed him in only one thing. No child had ever survived, and the last one had killed her. After Eliza's death, James Jarvie bought the house on St. Helena Island as a retreat, not a plantation, and he had buried himself here in grief. Caro and her mother paused at the foot of the stairs. From the dining room came the soft sound of the table being set, and a voice, not at all soft.
"She tell me I pull her hair like I ain't suited to be a lady's maid," Belle said.
"Talk low," said Dulcie.
Aggrieved, Belle did not.
Mrs. Kitty. Mrs. High and Mighty, and her daughter, too.
Belle?
Dulcie said, a tone very like a growl.
Why shouldn't I say it? Don't care how light-skinned they are, how fine they dress. Diamond ear bobs.
She snorted.
They slaves, the same as you and me.
Dulcie said, hush. They walked into the dining room, Kitty stepped light, her head high. She said,
I heard that.
Both slaves looked up in surprise. She continued,
but Mr. Jarvie considers me the mistress of the house. Belle, if you don't care to obey me, I can send you to the kitchen. Or back to Colleton County, to the field. Would you prefer that?
Belle dropped her eyes. She whispered,
no, ma'am.
Go. I need to talk to Dulcie.
When Belle was gone, Dulcie said,
she full of herself, Miss Catherine.
20 years ago, Dulcie and Kitty had been servants together, housemaid and kitchen maid. Now Kitty acted as the mistress of the house, and Dulcie obeyed her. Her mother had treated Dulcie with kindness. She had persuaded Caro's father to employ Dulcie's whole family as house servants, and Dulcie had the satisfaction of seeing her husband serve as the Jarvie coachman and her children as her assistants in the kitchen. Now Kitty said,
teach her, and if you can't, speak to me. I'll do that, Miss Catherine.
Caro tightened her arm around her mother's.
Papa is waiting, she reminded Kitty.
Her mother shook her head as though to clear it.
We won't disappoint him, she said, smiling.
Arm in arm, they sauntered into her father's study as though nothing had ever troubled either of them. Caro loved her father's study. It was full of the books he had bought as a student at Princeton, the tomes he had acquired when he read the law, and all the books since that he read for his own pleasure. Their leather bindings had a living smell, more so on a warm day, and she never minded that their covers gave up their reddish color to stain her hands. Her father preferred the ancients, in particular Cicero and Cato, and he had taught Caro Latin so she could read them for herself. But he also read history, telling her that it gave an educated person a better perception for the present. He didn't disdain novels. He was glad that she liked Sir Walter Scott and Charles Dickens, and he bought the newer authors for her too, like Nathaniel Hawthorne and Herman Melville. It was an unusual education for a girl, more so for a girl of color, and it was an even better gift than the hairbrush. He sat in his favorite armchair, the red velvet shiny from years of use, and put down his book.
Macaulay, he said to Caro, since I asked you to read it and give me your opinion.
He looked older than the man in the portrait. The gold of his hair had dulled a little, and his face no longer had a boy's smoothness. But his blue eyes were as lively as they had been in his youth, and now they were full of affection. He rose and put his arm around Kitty's waist.
You look beautiful, my dearest, he said, smiling,
and he kissed her cheek with more passion than was usually shown in a downstairs room. He hugged Caro with his free arm.
You look lovely, too, he said. My darling girls, both of you.
Is Mr. Pereira here yet? Kitty asked.
He's waiting in the parlor.
Is he here on legal business?
Benjamin Pereira, who lived in Charleston, was her father's lawyer, but he was a friend as well. He was the only Charleston man who regularly came to visit.
It's good to sit at the table with Mr. Pereira, Caro said too bitterly. Caro,
her mother's voice held a warning.
Papa, I wish that we could sit at the table whenever your guests come.
He shook his head.
Don't wish for such a thing, he said very softly. You know how it pains me to say no to you.
He squeezed Kitty's hand as he spoke to Caro, and they left the room together. She hadn't forgotten the dinner her father gave for the families of the island, even though it had been months ago. He had put it off and put it off until her mother was the one to say,
James, you have to invite them.
Her mother had seen to the dinner and directed the servants to ready the house. But before the guests arrived, she took Caro upstairs, retreating to her room to stay in the limbo between family and servant. Dulcie's daughter Peggy, who served as kitchen maid, brought up their meal. Peggy set the tray down on the pie crust table. She asked Kitty, "Ma'am, is there anything else you need?" Peggy, like Dulcie, had a strong low country accent. She said, "Is there anything else?" "No, Peggy, you go on." On the tray was the dinner put before the guests, the oysters, the shrimp remoulade, and the roast, accompanied by rice and greens. But Caro pushed it away. As the gentlemen arrived, their voices floated up the stairs, and as they settled into the dining room, their conversation came to Caro and her mother in bursts. The claret they drank made them louder.
"Still no Mrs. Jarvie?" someone asked, and the others laughed.
Even now her father was considered a catch, and all the families of Charleston and the Low Country hoped against hope that he would marry again. Caro hated it, but she knew that the world would never admit that he was already married to her mother. She was old enough to understand how it had happened, even though no one had explained it to her. How did a pretty light-skinned housemaid catch the eye of the widowed planter who owned her? However it had begun, it blossomed into a genuine affection, and once her mother was certain of her father, she allowed herself to feel something besides obligation. After Caro was born, her father gave up any pretense of trying to marry again. He had found the woman he loved, and he loved Caro as his child with equal tenderness. He had gone to the countryside to bury himself in grief. He stayed there to protect Kitty and Caro and to keep them a secret. Today, Pereira rose from his chair in the parlor in greeting.
"James," he said, shaking his friend's hand.
"Miss Catherine,"
he said, clasping Kitty's fingers as he would for any lady. And in a teasing tone, since he had watched her grow up, he added,
"And young Miss Caroline, you get prettier every day. Married in no time."
Caro blushed.
"I get smarter every day, too," she retorted.
Pereira knew that her father had educated her. Kitty said,
"And saucier as well."
That made Pereira laugh. Benjamin Pereira wasn't a planter. He was the son of a Portuguese Jew from London who had made his money as a merchant. Like her father, Pereira had read the law, but he practiced it and made a living by it, handling the affairs of men many times richer than himself. He was clever, diligent, and discreet. He kept all the family secrets of the men he served, the debts incurred by bad harvests and extravagance at the gaming table, and the surprises and the embarrassments written into the wills. He was younger than James was, with curly black hair and a swarthy complexion that would have cast a shadow over his life in Charleston if he and his family were not so well known. But his eyes were blue, startling in a man descended from Portuguese Jews. In the dining room, where the windows had been closed and the curtains drawn against the day's heat, both were now open to catch the afternoon breeze. The August sunlight slanted over the table, giving the gold-edged English china a greater gilding, and turning the claret and the crystal glasses a fiery ruby color. At the long table, big enough for a party of a dozen, they clustered together at one end, en famille. Pereira asked,
"What are you reading these days, Miss Caroline?"
She threw a glance at her father.
"Thomas Macaulay," she said, "when I'm not translating Cicero."
Pereira said,
"James? You're giving the girl a young man's education, a lawyer's education. Whatever will she do with it?"
Her father smiled.
"She'll comfort her father in his old age."
"Why shouldn't I go to college as you did?"
Caro teased them both. Her father teased her in return.
"As soon as Princeton College will allow it,"
he said. Caro knew as well as he did that the thought of a colored girl at Princeton College was a folly they could all laugh about together. But she knew something else.
"There is a college that would admit a young woman of color," she said.
"Is there?"
Pereira asked.
It's called Oberlin College, and it's in Ohio.
Laughing, Pereira said,
Oberlin College? A nest of vipers, from what I hear, mad against slavery.
Kitty said, Stop it, both of you. Don't lead her on so.
Her mother's glance said, Don't disappoint her so.
Caro sighed and fell silent. After the plates were cleared away, when the men retired to the study, Caro followed her mother to sit in the back parlor. Unlike the front parlor, heavy with mahogany and velvet from an earlier generation, and where portraits of previous Jarvies stared disapprovingly from the walls, the back parlor was Kitty's room, a lady's room, bright with new chintz and dainty in its furnishings. Her mother lit the candles against the coming dusk. Outside, the crickets had begun to rasp and the nighttime mosquitoes to whine. The air that came through the open windows smelled of magnolia and the faint odor of the midden from the kitchen, unavoidable in the heat. Kitty arranged herself on the settee, laying the most recent copy of Goady's Lady's book on her lap, and gestured to Caro to sit next to her. She laid a light hand on Caro's arm.
Caro, don't sulk. Come look at what's newest.
Shall we show it to our dressmaker to be in the latest fashion?
Her father indulged both of them in the matter of finery. He had their dresses made by a modiste in Charleston.
Caro didn't reply. Kitty coaxed her.
You'll need a new dress or two.
For the season?
Caro was sharp.
As though we have one.
Oh, Caro, her mother said, a tone of sorrow. You know why we don't.
The conversation at the table still bothered her.
I wish I had some reason to wear it besides showing it to Papa.
She knew better, but she pressed the point.
Like going to a maroon or a ball, as the free people of color in Charleston do.
The free colored families had a season just as the planter families did. Her mother's half-brother and half-sister, residents in Charleston, were free, but Kitty was estranged from them and Caro had never met them. Their freedom was a sore point with her mother. Caro had never learned the particulars of why they were free and her mother was not, and the estrangement between Kitty and her Bennett relatives had never been explained either.
Kitty said, Don't worry, Caro. We'll get you married somehow.
How? If we have no society, neither white nor colored.
Kitty didn't reply. Caro said,
Papa doesn't know what we'll do about it.
She needled her mother.
And neither do you.
With unusual severity, her mother said,
Caro, it won't be settled tonight. There's plenty of time to consider it. It isn't seemly for you to pick at me or your father. Stop it.
Caro rose.
Kitty asked, Where are you going? Upstairs to use the necessary. Is that all right?
Kitty shook her head.
You're as impertinent as that girl, Belle, she said. I'm the daughter of the house, and I can be as impertinent as I like, Caro said,
and she slipped into the hallway to stand in the spot where she could overhear everything that was said in the study. Her father's voice was audible through the closed door.
Ben, I need your advice about Caro.
Pereira sighed.
You can't free her, Jim. I know. Not if the petition for manumission has to go to the assembly. That damnable law, they've never approved one. They have. Just one. They freed the slave who unmasked Denmark Vesey's plot for a slave uprising. You can write it into your will, but you can't enforce it,
Pereira reminded him. In a brooding tone, her father said,
She's 18 and she's old enough to be married. Who will she marry?
So he was worried about it, as much as she and her mother were. Pereira said,
You've educated her beyond a marriage to a man who's a slave. There are educated men of color,
her father said. Pereira drew in his breath in a hiss so loud that Caro could hear it in the hallway. His older brother Jacob, now dead, had remained a bachelor all his life, but he had been faithful to a free woman of color and had provided for all four children they had together. Caro knew the story well,
because the woman was her mother's estranged half-sister Maria. Her father said,
"Like Maria's boys. How old are they now?"
Pereira said,
"They're kin to Miss Catherine, too. Certainly you could make an inquiry, send her to call on them, ask them to help. Kitty is bitter against them. She won't say why."
Caro heard a chair creaking. Pereira must have risen. He said,
"Her own notion isn't a bad one. To go north to Ohio. If you sent her to Oberlin, she would be safe there, and she would have the society of others like herself." "Send her away?"
her father asked. Pereira said,
"She could live as if she were free."
Her father hesitated, and when he spoke, there was a catch in his voice.
"I want to keep her close just a while longer,"
he said.
"No wedding, and no thought of Ohio."
The next day dawned as hot as the one before. In the dining room, on the sideboard, eggs and biscuits stayed warm in the chafing dishes, and beside them, last night's shrimp remoulade made a reappearance, having spent the night chilled in a block of ice from the ice house. It was so hot that Caro had little appetite. She nibbled at a biscuit, buttering each bite before she ate it in the genteel manner her mother had taught her.
"James," her mother asked, noticing that her father hadn't eaten much either, "are you feeling all right?"
He smiled. He looked pale, and there were dark circles under his eyes.
"Just a little headache," he said. "It's nothing."
"Shall I get you a draft of laudanum?"
"No, don't trouble yourself," he said. "It's nothing. The heat."
He smiled at her as he spooned eggs and shrimp onto his plate.
"Don't worry," he assured her. "I'm all right."
But he ate nothing, and by the end of the meal, he looked paler than before. He touched his fingers to his temple.
"I believe I'll rest for a while," he said.
Kitty said, "I'll make up a draft of laudanum. You go back upstairs and lie down." A headache might be a trifle that laudanum and a nap could treat, and it might be the first symptom of fever. Summer fever was serious. Black people usually recovered, but white people sickened and often died. Caro began to worry. She sat in the study and tried to read, but Macaulay didn't hold her attention. Everything in the study reminded her of her father, and it increased her worry. She moved to the back parlor and tried to hem a handkerchief. Her hand shook, and she stabbed herself with the needle and soiled the cloth with a drop of blood. Her mother found her sucking the blood from her finger. Kitty said,
"Caro, don't do that. It's unseemly. Ask Belle to bring you a sticking plaster, and use the thimble next time."
"How is he, Mama?"
"He's sleeping. I hope he's better when he wakes."
"What if he isn't?"
"Caro, stop it. People get headaches all the time in the heat. Don't fret."
"You're worried. I can see it." Kitty shook her head. She had seen fever, too.
"Don't make it worse," she said.
Despite their admonitions to each other, they worried. Every hour, Kitty ran upstairs, and every hour she reported,
"He's still asleep."
They ate a makeshift midday dinner that neither of them had an appetite for. Afterward, Kitty visited James again. She came down the stairs with an anxious expression on her face.
"Tell Dulcie to make up some lavender water," she said. "Tell her to use the ice."
"So it is fever,"
Caro said, her voice rising in alarm.
"There are all kinds of fever," Kitty said.
"Summer fever."
"Most recover. Both of us had it, and we recovered."
"Fever," Caro cried. "Why don't we go to the pines in the sickly season? Why do we stay in the low country where people get fever?"
"As though we could stay in Sumter County or in a hotel in Aiken."
"Lavender water," Kitty repeated. "Tell Dulcie, and tell her not to dawdle with it."
Caro brought a cloth and the bowl of water, icy to the touch and faintly fragrant of lavender, up the stairs, where her mother sat at her father's bedside.
The room had begun to smell of the sweater fever.
Caro handed her mother the cloth and held the bowl as Kitty dipped it into the water to bathe James's forehead, which was greasy with sweat.
He tried to smile at the cool touch of the cloth.
He said softly,
"That helps me."
"Hush," her mother said. "Don't tax yourself." He lay back on the pillows, and she draped the cloth over his forehead.
"Caro,"
he asked,
"will you sit with me, my love?"
"Yes, Papa."
"Give me your hand."
He squeezed her hand with his, which seemed hot, as though his fingers were fevered too.
"It's only a little fever. You had it. Do you remember?"
She remembered very well. She had been sick for days, her head pounding, her body burning. The doctor had come to purge her, and she was so nauseated that she needed no encouragement. She had slipped into a delirium, and through it, she had heard her mother weep and her irreligious father say,
"It's in God's hands now, Kitty."
"I nearly died of it," she cried.
He winced, and she was immediately repentant. He said faintly,
"Thank God you did not."
Kitty said sharply, "Caro, that's enough. If you can't speak in a low voice and talk about something more cheering, I'll send you downstairs."
"No, let her stay,"
James whispered.
"It does me good knowing that both of you are here."
He touched her cheek.
"Oh, Caro,"
he said.
"Cara."
He had taught her a little Italian, too. And even now the endearment stirred her. The next morning he was no better, and her worried mother sent for the doctor, who told them what they already knew. He recommended bleeding and an emetic. James said weakly,
"Just let me rest."
Kitty sent the doctor away. Caro rose and beckoned to her mother. In the hallway, she whispered,
"He's worse. Fever is like that,"
Kitty said stubbornly.
"Worse before it's better."
Kitty spent the night at James's bedside, refusing any help. Caro lay sleepless across the hall. She woke every hour, yanked from sleep in a sweat of fear. At daybreak, she threw back the covers and put on her dressing gown. The door to her father's room was ajar. Her mother had fallen asleep in the bedside chair. In sleep, she had released her grip on James's hand, and her fingers trailed against the skirt of her dress. Her father lay under the covers, his hair damp and his long, lanky body diminished. Caro tapped on the door, and her mother's eyes flew open. Startled, confused, she said,
"What is it?" "How is he?"
Caro whispered. He stirred and spoke through cracked lips.
"Caro, is that you?"
"Yes, Papa."
She slipped into the room. With effort, he opened his eyes. His eye whites had turned yellow, the telltale sign of yellow fever.
"Sit with me, Caro,"
he said, his voice as cracked as his lips. Her mother saw the yellowed eyes, and she rose, pressing her hand to her mouth to stifle a cry. Caro said softly,
"Mama, rest for a little. I'll stay with him."
"You'll fetch me?"
"Yes. Mama, rest."
As Kitty left, her father whispered,
"What is it, Caro? What's happened to make her weep so?"
"She sat with you all night. She slept in this chair. She's tired, Papa. You rest, too. Do you want anything?"
He shook his head. She reached for his hand and cradled it in her own. She thought,
"Not everyone dies of yellow fever. Perhaps Mama is right and he'll recover."
But his skin also began to yellow, another telltale that he was worse. They gave up all pretense of doing anything else,
and both of them stayed with him all the time, each of them holding a hand, getting up only to bathe his forehead or to run downstairs to ask Dulcie to replenish the warmed water with water newly chilled. Whenever he opened his eyes, Caro felt a stab of fear. They were the ungodly yellow of the yolk of a hard-boiled egg. When her mother descended the stairs with the water basin, Caro whispered,
"Papa, can you hear me?"
"Of course."
"Can you forgive me for the trouble I've caused you?"
"You've never caused me trouble,"
he said.
"None at all."
"For the time I argued with you about the season."
She had raged and cried about being denied a season last winter, even though she knew the reason perfectly well. He had sent her to the dressmaker for an extravagant new dress that no one would ever see besides her mother and himself. He said,
"You were so pretty in that dress."
He opened his yellowed eyes again. She bent her head and bit her lips. He refused food, saying that he was too sick to his stomach to eat. Kitty ignored him and brought in a bowl of broth. He choked at the smell, and Caro brought the basin just in time. The pretty mice-and-slop basin that ordinarily held the pitcher for his shaving water. Caro put her hand to her mouth in horror at the sight. The vomit was black with blood. It was the worst sign, the last sign. Caro's eyes met her mother's, and Kitty looked away, but not before the tears leaked from her eyes. Caro removed the basin and wiped her father's mouth. He tried to smile.
"Thank you,"
he whispered. He lay back on the pillow.
"Stay with me, both of you."
He took their hands, one in each of his own, as he often did at the dinner table instead of saying grace. They sat by his bedside, each of them clasping the weak paper hand. He opened his eyes, yellow swallowing up the familiar blue. He said,
"I'm dying."
In a voice thick with tears, Kitty said,
"James, no."
"Oh, beloved,"
he said. He lay back on the pillows, gathering strength. He pressed their hands with a shadow of his former strength. Unable to raise his voice, he said,
"I've tried to take care of you."
"Yes," Kitty said, her eyes full. "You always have."
"To make provision for you,"
he said, his voice slender as a thread. Kitty squeezed one hand and Caro the other. Kitty nodded and let the tears slip down her face. Caro, worried for them both, stifled a sob. They sat with him, bathing his forehead and holding his weakening hands, until the fever closed his eyes and stilled his voice. They watched until his breath became shallow and listened as it turned into a rail. When it stopped early in the morning, the room was lovely with sunlight and the air was very still. The scent of magnolia and rot came through the open window, and the smell of fever and lavender water lingered in the room. Still holding his hand, her mother bent over his body to kiss his lips. Her tears fell on his cheeks. Her father, who wanted to keep her close forever, who wanted to take care of her forever, was gone. Caro took his hand, still warm, and pressed it to her cheek.
"Caro," she whispered,
her own name and the word for a man beloved. Chapter 2. A Matter of Conscience. Emily Jarvie, her father Lawrence, and her stepmother Susan sat at breakfast in the dining room of the house in Sumter County that Susan's money had improved from a modest four-up-and-down structure into a house befitting a well-to-do planter. Her father shielded himself behind the newspaper sent from Charleston. He planned to run for election to the South Carolina Assembly in the fall,
and his lawyer's gaze never wavered from politics in Charleston, even in the quiet of their summer's retreat. She watched the curtains billow with the breeze that made the summer air of Sumter County so much cooler than Charleston's. As she buttered a biscuit, the butler hurried into the room with a letter on a tray, a worried look on his usually placid face.
"What is it, Marcus?"
Lawrence asked.
"Sorry to disturb you, sir."
Marcus had the accent of the Low Country, cleaned up for the big house.
"Letter just come for you."
Her father took it from the tray. Susan asked,
"Who is it from?"
"Benjamin Pereira. I know him, but not well. He's a lawyer in Charleston."
And so was her father himself. Emily knew that the lawyers of Charleston clustered together on Broad Street, as the turkey buzzards clustered at the Charleston market. Susan drew her brows together.
"Why is he writing to you?"
Her father opened the envelope and unfolded the letter. At the sight of the black border, Emily's heart sank. Her father read it and said slowly,
"My brother James died yesterday."
Emily had met her Uncle James, her father's elder brother, only once when she was very small. She had a shadowy memory of a tall, slender, smiling man with a cap of golden hair. He had knelt and spoken to her with affection, as though he were used to talking to a little girl.
"We didn't even know he was ill,"
Susan exclaimed. Lawrence shook his head.
"It was sudden," he said. "Yellow fever."
"When is the funeral?"
Her father gazed at a spot beyond his wife's head. His face, usually so taut and composed, seemed to sag.
"Mr. Pereira asks us to go there to arrange it," he said.
Susan shook her head.
"Is there no one else?"
Now her father shook his head.
"It will fall to us. How soon can we go there?"
"Must we hurry?" Susan asked. "You were estranged."
Her father's eyes clouded.
"Yes, we were," he said.
Emily knew that her uncle had left Charleston after his wife died, abandoning his law practice and a career that was expected to lead to a judge's seat. He had remained on St. Helena Island since, refusing invitations to the season in Charleston or to the healthier summer air of the hills and the pines. He had always remembered her, the niece he had rarely seen, by sending her a book on her birthday. The most recent gift had been a peculiar one for an unmarried girl. He had sent her a copy of Moby Dick. Emily looked absently out the window. The conversation between her father and stepmother was familiar yet far away, like the sound of the quarrelsome jays that lived in the woods beyond the house. She stared at her hands, which were very pale in her lap against the black of her dress. Emily had been in mourning for more than a year. Her betrothed, Robert Harriet, had died 2 months before the wedding, and she had mourned Robert as though they had already married. Her hand went to her throat, where she still wore the brooch made of a lock of his hair. At 19, Emily was well practiced in mourning. When she was 12, her mother died in childbed, and she had put on black for the first time. Her father, not knowing what to do with her, had sent her to Madame Devereux's Charleston Academy for young ladies. Even though her father lived in Charleston as well, she became a boarder who went home only twice a year. When she returned for her second summer, her father had remarried. Susan was kind to her and didn't pretend to be her mother. She didn't mind that Emily liked to read or that she spent so much time writing in her diary. When Lawrence complained that Emily preferred the company of books to society, whether in the house in Charleston or the pines of Sumter, Susan would say,
"Poor chick, she still misses her mother. Don't press her, Lawrence."
She sighed. Susan touched her arm in affection and asked,
"What is it, my dear?"
"Another funeral to attend,"
Susan said. Not a grief, though. Only a duty. She stroked the black sleeve of Emily's dress. Only a few days on St. Helena to put things in order. Emily's eyes filled with tears. She thought of Robert's death and his funeral, as she had every day since he was buried, and again she touched the brooch at her throat. Her father seemed diminished, shorter, quieter. In the depot of Stateburg, he bought their train tickets in silence, and once on the train, he left Emily and Susan in the first-class carriage and decamped for the smoking car, where men spat and drank in a fug of tobacco.
Goodness, her stepmother said. I've never seen him so quiet.
Emily smoothed the heavy black silk of her skirt and turned to gaze out the window at the familiar landscape. They never traveled from Stateburg to Charleston in the summer. That was the autumn journey, once the heat had broken and Charleston was safe from fever. It was peculiar to watch the pines disappear and to feel the summer's heat come through the windows. She shook her head but didn't reply, and her stepmother, who didn't feel right unless she was talking to someone, struck up a conversation with a lady across the aisle. Her father didn't reappear until the train stopped in Charleston. He found a carriage to take them to the wharf for the last leg of the journey on the ferry to Beaufort. When Emily was a little girl, when her mother was still alive, it had been fashionable to spend summers on the Sea Islands, in the belief that they were more healthful than Charleston. As they boarded the ferry, just like the river steamer she recalled from childhood, she had a vivid memory of standing at the railing beside her mother. Her mother's lavender scent had wafted toward her, softening the salty, marshy smell of the inlets that marked this part of the coast. Her mother had put her arm around Emily's shoulders and drawn her close. In her soft voice, she had said, "Do you recall how much pleasure we had last year? You'll see all your friends again." Now, on the boat, Susan found a spot in the saloon and insisted that Lawrence sit with them at the little iron table. She waved away the slave who offered them refreshment. She said, "Lawrence, sit still. There are arrangements to be made." Her father shifted in his chair.
"Once we get there," he said,
"there's so much to do. A funeral to plan, and then the estate to settle."
Despite her father's air of command, Emily knew full well that her stepmother was the real manager in the Jarvie household. Her father would write the bank drafts, but her stepmother would arrange for the funeral service and the funeral breakfast. Her father nodded but didn't speak.
"And the houses to look after? That big place in Colleton County, and the grand house in Charleston. The Harriet House, it's yours now."
Her father didn't reply, and Susan said happily,
"I wouldn't mind living in Charleston in a house like that."
"Not yet, Susan."
She leaned forward.
"We can plan, can we not? What we'll do once you become the head of the family?"
Her father raised his head. There was a spot of red on his pale cheeks.
"Not yet. Not now."
"Grieving or not, there is so much to take care of."
Her father pressed his hands against the edge of the table with such force that his knuckles showed white.
"Stop it,"
he said, raising his voice.
"It's not seemly."
He rose and strode to the railing. He stared out at the water with a rigid posture that recalled his youthful days at the military academy, where he had studied as a cadet. Susan said to Emily,
"There was no love lost with James. I don't know what's gotten into him."
Emily thought, "I believe I do," and she rose to follow him. She leaned against the railing without speaking. He spoke so softly that she had to lean close to hear him.
"I always hoped that we might speak again, James and I," he said, "that we might reconcile someday."
She turned her head. To her surprise, her father covered her hand with his own, and she let it rest there. Even more softly, he said,
"And now we never will."
She didn't reply, and they looked over the water together. At the pier in Beaufort, they were met by a servant who introduced himself as the Jarvie coachman. He was a short man with bowed legs, his face weathered and seamed.
"What is your name?" her father asked.
"Henry, sir."
"Have you been with the family long?"
"All my life, sir. My wife Dulcie, too, she the cook."
"Lawrence, let him load our trunks," Susan said. "You don't have to flatter him. He can't vote for you."
Emily was startled. Her stepmother was usually a staunch support to her father's ambition to the assembly and to the family ambition, the judge's seat beyond it. She had told Emily that she would enjoy being the wife of a Charleston judge. James's death, which opened the prospect of a new standing in Charleston, had stirred new ambitions in her. Her father's cheeks flamed red again, that spot like a dab of badly applied paint.
"It never hurts to act the gentleman," he reminded his wife.
Emily felt a flash of irritation, but she laid her hand on Susan's arm.
"You know that Papa will flatter anyone," she said. "It's in his nature."
She tried to smile.
"That's enough,"
Susan said, shaking herself free and giving Henry a sharp look. Henry said softly,
"Missus, things in disorder with Marse James's passing. We all love him, and we upset. We try to do our best for you now."
Emily glanced at Henry, whose face was set in a perfect expression of contrition, and thought, "Who is the better flatterer?" Even though her memory was old and faded, Emily recognized the houses along the road to her uncle's place. The plantations on St. Helena Island dated from the early years of the century, before ostentation had overtaken country houses, and they were gracious two-story affairs, with porches on each story to catch the sea breezes, and were painted white to deflect the heat of summer. She had never visited her uncle's house, but when the coach pulled up, she felt at home. It was just like the houses where they had stayed when she was a child. And as she took it in, she imagined that she smelled lavender beneath the perfume of jessamine and the flowers the slaves called hesheberry. When Lawrence helped them out, her stepmother rustled her skirts in her impatience. She admonished the coachman.
"You take good care of those trunks."
Henry nodded and bent his head in deference.
"Yes, missus."
The door opened as they mounted the stairs. A light-skinned servant, his temples frosted with gray, stood in the doorway. He said softly,
"I'm so sorry, ma'am. We out of sorts here since Marse James passed on."
"I've come to do what I can," Susan announced.
She swept past him, and Emily reluctantly followed. The curtains had been drawn, and the house was hushed. Someone had covered the mirror in the entryway, and the grandfather clock in the corner had been stopped so it did not tick or strike the hour while the inhabitants grieved. In a house without a wife, Emily wondered who had thought to prepare the house for mourning like that.
"Where is Mr. Jarvie?"
Susan asked the butler.
"Upstairs, ma'am. They laying him out."
"Take me up there,"
the butler said.
"Let me settle you for a moment in the parlor. Bring you something."
Susan pulled off her gloves.
"Show us upstairs."
Reluctantly, he led them up the wide staircase to the second floor and tapped on the bedroom door, which was ajar. A distracted voice called,
"What is it, Ambrose?"
"Mrs. Lawrence Jarvie and her daughter, ma'am."
"Why did you bring them up? We aren't ready for them."
From the room drifted the smell of rubbing alcohol and lavender. Susan pushed past Ambrose and said,
"We've come to make ourselves useful if we can."
The deceased, clad in his nightshirt, lay on the coverlet, his body carefully straightened, his eyes closed. A dark-skinned servant in a neat gray dress and a clean apron held a basin of water. Another servant wrung a cloth into it. A tall, slender woman dressed in deep mourning bent over the dead man. Beside her stood a girl, also in the deepest mourning, her hand on the older woman's arm.
They were so fair of skin that at first Emily didn't realize they were colored. Susan addressed the older of the aproned women.
"What's your name?" she demanded.
"Dulcie, ma'am."
She dropped her eyes. Susan turned to the younger.
"And you?"
"Belle, ma'am,"
she whispered. Susan turned to the slender, ivory-skinned woman in the dress of a widow.
"And you?"
she asked.
"I'm Mrs. Jarvie," she said in a low tone.
As Susan's face registered surprise, she said,
"Mrs. Catherine Bennett Jarvie."
She gestured toward the girl. Her skin was lighter than the older woman's, but her expression was the same, all too familiar to Emily, the sheen of sleeplessness over the days of grief.
"This is my daughter, Miss Caroline Jarvie."
Susan grabbed Emily's hand. She pulled Emily down the stairs and marched through the house looking for the room where the butler had settled her husband. She found Lawrence in the study, sitting in a wing chair worn with use.
"My uncle must have loved that chair," Emily thought.
A decanter sat on the table by her father's elbow, and the room smelled of warmed whiskey. Susan flung her wadded gloves onto the table next to the decanter. Lawrence looked up.
"What is it?"
he asked.
"How bad is the disorder?"
He sipped the whiskey.
"They warned you."
Her stepmother dropped into a nearby chair, struggling for words. She said,
"There's a slave woman in the house who calls herself Mrs. Jarvie."
"I beg your pardon?"
her father asked. Susan cried,
"She thinks of herself as his wife."
Her father's voice took on the lawyer's tone, the sound of a man who asked distraught people questions to get at the truth.
"Are there children?"
"A daughter, almost grown."
"And what does the girl call herself?"
Susan sent Emily an imploring glance. "Help me," it said. "Be outraged along with me."
"Miss Jarvie," she said.
Emily spoke.
"Her name is Caroline," she said.
Susan asked, "What possessed him?"
Emily thought, "Didn't you see it? How beautiful they are, both of them." She recalled the look of dazed pain on both of those lovely light-skinned faces.
"And how stricken."
Her father drained his glass.
"So that's what he was hiding living down here."
Susan said,
"There's no thought of a funeral in Charleston. I can't imagine burying him at St. Michael's."
Her father shook his head.
"Lawrence, I don't care what they call themselves. They can't stay in the house."
Emily, who had remained standing, could not forget the look of grief on Caroline's lovely face. She was louder and sharper than she intended.
"Mother, leave them be. Let them grieve. Wait until after the funeral."
Susan turned to her and spoke with a fury Emily had never felt from her stepmother before.
"Who asked you?"
Susan's insistence on a hushed funeral meant that she declined to hold the service in Beaufort, which had a well-established Episcopal church. She went to the tiny church on St. Helena itself, called the White Church, because it had no provision for slaves to worship there. The minister told Susan that he would make an exception for the servants at the funeral.
"Let the people grieve for their master," he said. "He was a kindly man, and they loved him."
Emily saw Susan bristle. Did the minister know the truth? Susan said,
"If you can't accommodate them,
they can sit in the back pews by the door,"
the minister said.
Her father said decisively, "Yes, we'll allow it."
"Lawrence!"
"Until after the funeral, Susan."
With a noiseless step, Emily entered the church flanked by her father and stepmother. It was melancholy to attend another funeral, since it reminded her so vividly of Robert's, when she had been so afflicted that she had buried her face in her handkerchief. Today, as at Robert's service, the air was hot and still, heavy with the lingering smell of Sunday's incense, the silence broken by the murmur of people greeting each other as they slid into the pews. Emily lingered near the door where the Jarvie slaves had been accommodated. The men were in black suits, the women in dresses hastily dyed black, all of them clustered together in a phalanx of mourning for their master. In their midst sat Catherine and Caroline Jarvie, who were clad in sumptuous black dresses. But they hadn't dared to wear the lady's mourning bonnet. They had wrapped their heads in the scarves of slaves and tied them in the manner of the Low Country, with the black silk ends resting on their heads like a butterfly's wings. In the pew just ahead, also close to the door, sat a stranger, a slender man with a swarthy complexion. He wore black, as men usually did, but his face was drawn and pale, as though he had reason to grieve. Susan pulled on Emily's hand to guide her where she belonged, in the front row, as one of the chief mourners. The hurried funeral had been badly attended, and few people returned to the house to pay their respects. The black Jarvies had gone upstairs. The house was quiet, not the pleasant quiet of an afternoon nap, but the painful quiet of loss. Talk silenced, laughter stilled, hope extinguished. The white Jarvies sat in the study awaiting James's lawyer. Susan asked, "When is he coming?" Her father closed the paper, making it rustle, and said, "I told you at 2. Soon." Susan said irritably, "Lawrence, don't rustle the pages so." Emily nodded her hands in her lap and said nothing. Susan said, "Pereira, you said his name was? Who are his people? I don't remember anyone with a Low Country place named Pereira." Emily said, "I knew a girl named Mimi Pereira at Madame Devereaux's. Her father was a merchant. They're Israelites." Lawrence said,
"Mordecai Cohen is an Israelite, and he has 1,000 acres and 600 hands on the coast."
"But this man? I thought you said he was a Charleston lawyer, not a planter."
"I've seen him on Queen Street. We have professional acquaintance in common. I didn't say I knew him well. I will say that I'm not sure I can trust a man who doesn't set foot in a church."
"I shudder to think of what's in that will," Susan said.
Her father sat upright and winced as though his back hurt him.
"We'll know soon enough."
At the sound of the knock on the door, they heard footsteps on the stairs. Before Ambrose could open the door, Catherine Jarvie's voice drifted from the foyer.
"Let me greet him," she said, as though she were still mistress of the house.
They heard a low-pitched voice say,
"Kitty, Caro, I am so sorry."
Ambrose interrupted,
"Mr. Pereira, sir, let me show you into the parlor."
Ambrose showed them in, and without asking, the two colored women entered, still in their black funeral dresses. They had removed the scarves. Their heads were bare, their dark hair silky around their ears. Catherine Jarvie said,
"Thank you, Ambrose."
She extended her hand to Lawrence.
"Mr. Jarvie," she said.
Her father stared at the hand so graciously proffered. He said gruffly,
"Surely you don't expect me to shake your hand?"
The girl Caroline plucked at her mother's sleeve.
"Mama," she said softly.
The room was so quiet that Emily could hear herself breathing. She shifted in her chair. She looked down at her hands. She was too uncomfortable to raise her head and look at the woman James had called his wife and the girl who was his daughter.
"Mr. Jarvie, we've met,"
Pereira said.
"There was no need for you to trouble yourself," her father said. "I'm capable of reading a will, you know."
"Of course," Pereira said gently.
"But you know as well as I do that no man should lawyer himself, especially in such melancholy circumstances."
Lawrence gestured toward the two colored women.
"Why are they here?"
Pereira said,
"They were close to your brother. He would have wished them to hear the provisions of the will."
When Pereira extended his hand to her, Emily recognized the stranger from the church. Her classmate Mimi Pereira had been blessed with bright blue eyes, and the trait ran in the family because Benjamin Pereira had keen blue eyes in his swarthy face.
If I didn't know he was an Israelite, Emily thought, I might think he was colored.
Pereira was older than her father. He was probably close to James in age, but he carried himself with a surprising grace, the light and easy step of a man who might like to dance. Emily wondered what kind of will her uncle and this nimble man had devised together. Pereira said, to no one in particular,
May I sit at the desk?
He opened the portfolio he carried and laid the will on the desk. Seated, he began to read in a low, sonorous voice,
I, James Durand Jarvie, of the parish of St. Helena Island in the state of South Carolina, being of good health and sound mind and memory, declare that this is my last will and testament. I hereby direct that all my just debts, both funeral and testamentary expenses, be fully paid and satisfied as soon as possible after my death.
He paused, as though reminding them, and continued.
I devise and bequeath to my brother, Henry Lawrence Jarvie, and his heirs and assigns all my lands at Colleton County in the state of South Carolina, the plantation and tract of land bequeathed to me by my father, John Jarvie, as well as the house, its contents, and the slaves upon it, as well as the house and lands on St. Helena Island. I also devise and bequeath to my brother, Henry Lawrence Jarvie, and his heirs and assigns, my house in King Street in Charleston, with all its contents. Item, I devise and bequeath to my niece, Emily Caroline Jarvie, 12 books from my library, the particulars to be left to her discretion.
Startled, Emily thought, To him I was still the little girl who liked to read. Pereira read,
I also devise and bequeath my aforementioned brother the following Negro slaves who are employed as servants in my house.
He paused, and Catherine and Caroline sat motionless. Emily would swear they had stopped breathing. Pereira continued,
Ambrose, Henry, his wife Dulcie, their daughters Peggy and Mattie, and their son Hank, also Lydia and Belle.
All of them waited to hear what James Jarvie had devised for the other two. Pereira read,
For my servant Catherine, also called Kitty, who has been so faithful to me, forsaking all others, and her daughter Caroline, also called Caro, beloved to me, I appoint my brother Henry Lawrence Jarvie to be their guardian, and to treat them with kindness as he would members of the family, and that he free them as soon as it becomes possible.
Pereira settled his gaze on Lawrence and read,
I do hereby nominate, constitute, and appoint my brother Henry Lawrence Jarvie, executor of this, my will.
In the silence, Pereira added,
He added a list of the slaves on his plantation in Colleton County, as well as the livestock, and also an inventory of the contents of this house, including his carriage and horses. I won't read it, but you can examine it at your leisure, and let me know if you find any confusion or discrepancy.
Her father said,
Treat them as members of the family.
The lawyer's tone, confirming his understanding.
He felt that way about all his servants, that they were to be treated with kindness as members of the family.
Her father's eyes swept over Catherine and Caro, who sat unmoving, their black dresses severe against the red velvet of the side chairs in which they sat.
He meant more than that.
Pereira said,
He meant for you to take care of them. How? To make provision for them and to maintain them.
Her father's voice rose as if he were making a point in the courtroom.
Did my brother leave anything for their maintenance? Did he set aside any money for it?
There's enough in the estate for that, as for the other servants.
Did he really want me to free them?
Both Catherine and Caroline flinched as though they had been slapped.
In that, he trusted you to follow your conscience,
Pereira said quietly. Emily swallowed. She glanced at Caroline, a sidelong glance, and saw how she knotted her hands in her lap. She was so fair of skin that her knuckles showed white against the black dress. To the look of exhaustion and grief on Caroline's face was added the pallor of shock. Emily dared to let her eyes linger on them both, the widow and the orphan, and felt their grief sing along her nerves and reverberate in her heart. Her stepmother dismissed the two women, and her father offered Mr. Pereira refreshment, which he declined, saying that the press of business summoned him back to Charleston. As soon as Ambrose closed the door behind him, Susan turned to Lawrence. She wrung her handkerchief in her hands as though she wanted to tear it asunder. She said, "We'll have to sell them." Her father sat up with the straight spine of the military man that his father had wanted him to be.
"I can't," he answered.
"Why not?"
"James has made his wishes clear."
Susan's eyes blazed, anger turning their blue dark and murky.
"You never spoke to him when he was alive," she said. "You never considered him, not for a moment. Why do you let him order you now that he's in his grave?"
Her father flushed a feverish red.
"I won't defy the provision of his will."
"Oh, nonsense. No one knows what the will says except for us."
"And Pereira,"
her father said. He gestured toward the second floor.
"And them."
"Lawyers don't tell secrets.
Not if they want to do business."
She gestured toward the second floor, too, the ragged handkerchief waving in the air.
"And no one will listen to anything they say."
Her father leaned forward, but Susan interrupted his unspoken words. "When we get back to Charleston, we'll arrange it." Her father leaned farther forward. Emily had never seen him look like that, his mouth so tight, his eyes so narrow.
"The moment they go on to the auction block, everyone will know. It will no longer be a secret. Or private shame. It will come into the full light of day. Do you want that?"
Her stepmother stared at her father as though he were a fool.
"Not if you sell them in Mississippi or in New Orleans."
"As though slave dealers are discreet."
Her stepmother continued to glare at the man she had married.
"I won't have them in my house," she said. "I won't stand for that."
Her father glared back at the woman he had promised to cherish.
"We'll make some arrangement," he said.
The next morning, as Emily read in the back parlor, her stepmother marched into the room, a bundle of cloth in her arms.
"Emily, come with me."
Emily looked up from her book.
"What is it, Mother?"
"I need you to help me."
Two grim lines showed on either side of her stepmother's mouth. Emily sighed and closed the book. She followed her stepmother up the stairs to the room that had been Kitty's. The door was closed, but her mother threw it open without knocking. Kitty and Caro sat side by side on the bed, still dressed in their mourning finery. They held hands. Both raised their heads at the sight of Susan, but neither spoke. Susan said,
"Get up, both of you."
Wordlessly, still holding hands, they rose. Susan said,
"You can't stay in the house. You'll leave today."
"Where will we go?" Kitty asked.
"You'll call me ma'am," Susan said, her voice cold.
Kitty raised her eyes to Susan's.
"Where will we go, ma'am?"
"There's a cabin for you on the Nigger Street."
Kitty drew in her breath in surprise.
"The Nigger Street?"
"Don't talk back to me," Susan snapped.
"Wherever we go, we'll need some time to gather our things," Kitty said. "Ma'am?"
Her stepmother's eyes flashed.
"You won't take anything that's in the house," she added. "Not your dresses or your jewelry."
Kitty let her eyes linger on her new mistress's face.
James gave those things to me,
Susan said.
Your master's gifts don't belong to you. Nothing in this house belongs to you.
Caro clutched her mother's hand.
My books. Let me take my books.
Books? Nothing leaves the house. None of it is yours, Susan repeated.
Emily spoke.
Mother, at least let her have a Bible.
Bible? She shouldn't be able to read a book.
Susan glowered at Emily.
And don't you think of giving her one.
Susan had often been curt with her servants, but Emily had never heard her speak so hatefully to a slave. Susan snapped,
You'll leave those dresses.
Kitty stared at Susan, but Caro cried out,
Will we go away naked?
Susan lifted the bundle she carried in her arms.
I've brought you clothes.
She undid the bundle and handed it to Kitty.
Take off your clothes and put these.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.